the universe is a vast place. And sometimes I wonder if it's just as crazy out there somewhere. Hello and welcome to a new episode of Out There. On a cloudless night without light pollution, we can see thousands of stars in the sky. Each of them is an object like our sun, and that's just a fraction of the hundreds of billions of stars in our galaxy alone. Each of them is orbited by at least one planet, and according to the latest findings, there are 20 times more planets drifting through the galaxy, as lonely, cold and dark worlds abandoned by their stars. Considering that our galaxy is just one of hundreds of billions, it seems almost impossible that only this one planet has given rise to life. The question I ponder is not whether there is life out there, but how far away it is. Since the universe is also billions of years old, it is unlikely there is a plethora of intelligent alien life, because by now it should be everywhere, and the sky should be full of their signals. However, when we look at life on Earth, we realize that for 4 billion years there have been incredible life forms here. But intelligent life has only emerged recently, probably due to a convergence of many extraordinary circumstances. A planet with life, it seems, is by no means synonymous with a planet with intelligent life. There are species that haven't changed in hundreds of millions of years. Intelligence does not appear to be the goal of evolution. It is one of many outcomes. But what this tells me is that in our galaxy alone, there can be countless planets with non-intelligent life. Perhaps somewhere out there, there is still a world with a jungle or a form of life we have yet to encounter. By contemplating such matters, we occasionally discover something new about our own planet and learn to appreciate it even more. So allow me to take you on a brief journey to three planets that I imagine many light years away. Our first stop is a planet I'll call Sporomutus. It orbits a red dwarf of the M class. These stars are very common and long-lived, but smaller than the Sun with less energy output. The habitable zone, the region where it's neither too hot nor too cold, is closer to the star. However, this can result in tidal locking, meaning it always shows the same side to the star. There is no day and night cycle. One side is a lifeless desert, the other shrouded in perpetual ice. Additionally, this star tends to emit an increased dose of UV and X-ray radiation, which is not in favor of life as we know it. Nevertheless, life exists here, along a narrow band in the eternal twilight, where the sun hovers just above the horizon. But we don't see a jungle. We see a colorful landscape, but the rocks appear to be painted and have peculiar protrusions. Something resembling colorful dust floats in the air, but not much else is visible. This is a world shaped by microscopic life. The battles that occur here are invisible to the naked eye. The star's harmful radiation and unpredictability have led to short life cycles and rapid mutations. Yet life has found a way to persist and start anew. Here there are armies of creatures, carried by the wind, like dust, colonizing new areas and creating tiny structures. Some of them can convert the star's energy into biological energy, similar to plant photosynthesis, thus sustaining the circle of life. Toward the sunny side, it's about protecting oneself from the sun, and the surfaces become brighter to reflect as much as possible. Towards the night side, it is about absorbing as much energy as possible, so the surfaces become darker. it would not be advisable for an astronaut to step out on this planet, even with a spacesuit, as there are enough microorganisms that can break down any material into its components. Although it may not look like it, this planet boasts a density of species that would put Earth's life to shame. Let's move on to our next destination, a planet I'll call Cryonomad. It's a rogue planet that doesn't orbit the star, but travels through the galaxy with an unknown destination. Due to the absence of sunlight, the vast amount of water on its surface has frozen it to an ice cover many kilometers thick. However, deep within the planet, it still possesses a hot core, and additional heat from radioactive decay in the rocks heats this ice from below, allowing an ancient deep ocean of liquid water to exist. In this world of darkness, there is life. Perhaps remnants of life that swam in the planet's ocean when it still orbited its star. Or perhaps it was born in this darkness. Regardless, it has perfectly adapted to this environment. Enormous bioluminescent creatures swim through the darkness, unaware that there's a world out there with a sky full of stars. Forests of tentacles and teeth compete for the energy flowing from below. Similar communities exist on Earth's ocean floors independent from the sun, where hot water emanates from the depths. But on Cryonomad, life may never reach the surface until its core cools down and a sphere of ice drifts alone through the cosmos. Our final destination on this journey through the galaxy takes us to the central region. Here the density of stars is enormous, and paths become unpredictable. Dying stars that explode in supernovae and gamma ray bursts make it almost impossible for planets to have life-friendly conditions. However, despite all this, there's a region where things have been relatively calm for a long time. The planet I'll call Galaxia orbits a binary star system. One star is of the class A, and its smaller companion is of the class G, much like our Sun. The larger star is the primary energy source. Stars of this type also generate an extreme magnetic field, which provides some protection against radiation to the system. Unfortunately, this star doesn't live as long as its smaller companion, but it has been sufficient to provide ideal conditions on Galaxia. This planet is most similar to Earth. Here we find our jungle, but it's predominantly purple. This is because the energy harvesting system in plants is based on the molecule retinol, instead of the chlorophyll molecule found on Earth that results in green plants. There might even have been a time when Earth was purple. This was due to microorganisms long before plants. The planet is more massive than Earth, so it has higher gravity, resulting in stockier life forms. However, the denser atmosphere, which is also a result of gravity, makes it easier to take flight. It is more like a swimming through the air. But the most impressive moment on Galaxia is when the night falls. The view of the stars in the center of the galaxy is unlike anything you could see on Earth. This was just a brief excursion to the fantastic places that might exist out there. If you'd like to hear more about these three worlds, let me know in the comments. And I'll think further about the life on Sporomutus, Cryonomad and Galaxia, introducing you to some of their inhabitants. In any case, the purpose of this exercise is to make us appreciate life on our own little blue dot even more. Because I'm on 1415 and the real world is incredible.